Thou shalt drink craft beer.
Thou shalt drink craft beer.
I'd be more likely to follow that 11th commandment than if that were the case.
Tech Hockey Guide presents the Chasing McNaughton Podcast, covering the Michigan Tech Huskies and the WCHA with your host, Tim Braun, Rob Gilreath, and Dustin Lindstrom.
Thank you to our new introduction from Mitch Lake. Welcome to episode 5 of the Chasing McNaughton Podcast. Thanks for joining us. This week, our guest is Shane Frederick from the Mankato Free Press, but he'll be joining us a little bit later. So let's do the thank you notes, plus a brief note from our sponsor, and we'll come back and start with the review of the Clarkson series, I guess, huh, guys?
Sounds good.
That'll do.
All right. Welcome back. Let's discuss the Clarkson series and its pairwise implications, and then maybe we'll get into the Joe show a little bit from this week. I don't know about you guys, but it was frustrating Saturday night. I know, Dustin, you kind of hinted that this might be the way the weekend went, but I certainly, until that five-minute major, I didn't think it was going to go that way. I thought I was going to be right, but it all kind of fell apart for them in that 1 minute during that major penalty.
Yeah, I think Clarkson is, you know, like I said last week, Clarkson's a good team, and they showed why they're a good team. They pounced when they had an opportunity, and they played a very solid game after that.
It was tough. You know, once they got the lead, Tech struggled. I mean, they had some opportunities, but on the Joe show today, he did talk, or this week, he did talk a lot about and even post game about it kind of playing into their hands with all the penalties that that Clarkson was able to shorten their bench and really focus on their top line and get them a lot of playing time with all the special teams that happened in that third period, and it certainly helped them.
Angles in their top line was definitely giving Tech a run for the money. So the more time those guys can spend on the ice with the power play situations, you know, it's only going to play to Clarkson's favor there. I think when we were rolling all the lines playing without the special teams, you could tell that we got a little bit more depth, I think, even than them. The third period on Friday, I think, is one of the best periods of hockey I've seen Tech play, and it was ridiculous. What was it, 18 shots to 2 shots or something like that was the final byline shot line for that one?
Yeah, I don't know, something like that. I know it was not. It was a good game. I did enjoy it, you know, and it's not that Clarkson didn't have their chances, but it did feel like that was a game. I guess both teams could have felt like they should have won that game, but it did feel like Tech was the team maybe more so.
Well, I think without the special teams, we come away winning that Saturday night game.
Well, but I meant Friday with that domination in the third that we had all the chances to get the lead. Not so much overtime, but you know, that third period, I definitely thought we...
Did we have a shot in overtime? I don't
know. We don't have a shot on goal.
I don't think we did.
That registered. And yeah, I don't think we got charts for some reason. I don't know. I'd have to talk to Jonathan about that. But yeah, it was 18-2 in the third, 3-0 Clarkson in overtime. I mean, it did feel like a game that was back and forth enough that you understand, like maybe neither team was happy with a tie, but they both deserved something out of that game.
Yeah, is, you know, how the game should end in that case and not go to stupid stuff. Both teams played well,
like,
back and forth.
I now have a term for it. I saw it on Twitter. A couple guys were complaining that the Clarkson game didn't continue into super time.
Apparently, yeah, that's no, the stupid term. Time is more like it. Yeah. I don't mind the original overtime. The original first period overtime, 5-on-5 is fine.
I kind of do.
You give them that chance.
Like, I like it.
Put it on the line.
I like it, but I don't like the fact that, from a pairwise perspective, it doesn't matter if you win in the 62nd minute or the 59th. That's what I don't like about it.
Sure.
Like, I feel like if you're tied after regulation, it should mean something to pairwise because that's the apples to apples comparison. But
yeah, I could see that.
Who knows? I don't know. What you got going on over there, Dustin? What do you got? Anything else to say about Clarkson?
No, I don't think so. It unfortunately, it did kind of turn out what I was expecting. They did give me a little bit of hope on Saturday night, so that kind of sucked for me too.
Oh, the arena was buzzing too. And then it just like deflated after that five.
So, Rob, I just wanted to call back to last week.
No.
we don't do that. We live in the present here, Dustin.
Apparently, scoring the first goal wasn't the best idea.
I think it's always a good idea because I still think we're better when we score first than when we don't, but we are not perfect.
I'll add a part two to my rules for winning a hockey game. Score the first goal and then continue to not give up more goals.
I think I'll take scoring the second, third, and fourth goal.
Yeah, those would have been fine this weekend, too.
Regardless of who scores the first.
If we can get to three, that's always a good thing, right?
All I know is that volleyball spikes, I think those ought to come back into style and be legal. I'd have thrown my hat for a volleyball spike goal.
Yeah. Well, the swat in, yeah.
Yeah, it was Bretzman again. Yeah, Bretzman is the one that swatted it down.
Yeah.
And I was in the blue line box, you know, for the game. And in between the periods, a couple of old goalies were talking about that. And specifically mentioned that would have been a fine goal in their time. I don't know why it's not a goal now.
I think I get why it's not a goal, but
I do too.
I don't think I'd want that to count.
He didn't go directly in.
No, it went off the goalie.
He bounced it off the goalie first. That should count.
Yeah.
The other team touched it. Clear possession
right
there.
That's not a
goal
in broomball either. So.
I know. I actually had to whistle a broomball goal down for that last night down here in the Fox Valley reffing.
Yeah.
Well, when some professional wrestling guy decides to make the hockey version of the XFL, anything will be legal. If the puck is in the net, it doesn't matter how it gets there.
Why do I have a feeling that will never happen?
You just got to throw the glow puck back on, and if it's hit by a hand, it turns a different color.
Yeah.
So one other thing, Joe kind of touched on it in this week's show too, was about pairwise implications. I think he was a little heavy-handed on the numbers, but let me pull it up here because I did post it for you guys. If they had won Saturday instead of losing, like held on, not had the stupid major, Tech would currently be 11th in the pairwise and have 178 more points in the RPI. Instead, they're, 19th right now, I think?
18th.
18th as of today?
Yep.
Okay, because I know there was some Sunday games that tweaked it a little more.
Yeah, I looked just before the show. It was 18th.
All right. Let's see. So that's 7 places in the pairwise and 178 points. We're going to go to the interview with Shane Frederick now from the Mankato Free Press. He was nice enough to join us. His phone connection wasn't the best, but we really are just learning how to use some new equipment, and we didn't really know how to fix it the best, so I apologize in advance, but here's the interview with Shane Frederick. So, welcome to the show, Shane Frederick from the Mankato Free Press. I suppose we can get right into Minnesota State last weekend and the season. I know you didn't get to watch in person, and I actually saw you complain a little bit about flow hockey. What happened there for you?
Well, I think it was weird on Friday night. The whole first period was not on flow hockey. They kept changing the time of when they were going to try to get it going, and I don't know if it was a connection from inside the arena. I'm not 100% sure how that all works. So, I feel bad.
I'm pretty sure we can just blame it on the fact that Northern sucks.
Northern sucks. Yeah, we'll just blame it on Northern sucking. Because Rob has to say that every week.
I'll let you guys handle that part of it. But it was just unfortunate. I didn't get to watch the first period of it. I know there were a lot of other MSU Mankato fans who were upset about it, you know, considering the run that they've been on and the winning streak being number one in the country. I think there's just obviously a lot of interest down here in Mankato and amongst Minnesota State fans. So there's some disappointment that they didn't get to see the beginning of that, but eventually they got it going. So, and then it was fine. I think it was fine on Saturday.
Well, that's good. It's been quite the run for you guys. What are your impressions of them through the first half?
Well, you know, it's funny. You know, I was thinking about this today a little bit about the, you know, having that winning streak come to an end on Saturday night and probably some disappointment amongst fans and the team itself. But to be 15-2-1 through the first half of the schedule at the exact halfway point, I don't know if anyone would have saw that coming, even with as good as everyone thought Minnesota State was going to be this year, considering everybody who's been back. So it's really been an impressive run that they've been on, you know, playing a pretty tough schedule for the most part with North Dakota, going up to Minnesota Duluth, Arizona State, playing Tech, playing Northern on the road, both of those road trips. Pretty challenging schedule off the bat, and to be 15-2-1, you probably couldn't ask for much better than that.
Yeah, it's been pretty impressive. I know the last week or the week before, we talked a little bit about Dryden McKay and just how amazing he's been this year. Did you really expect him to be quite that good?
I don't think I expected him to put up even better numbers, at least so far, than he did last year. Last year he put up pretty impressive ones. I think what's amazing, I wrote a column about this a couple weeks ago, is that, you know, over Mike Hastings' time at Minnesota State, there really hasn't been any consistency year to year with the goaltending other than the numbers themselves. But in terms of, you know, who is actually the, you know, the guy in goal, you go from Stephon Williams to Cole Huggins, back to Stephon Williams. Huggins then kind of shares things with Pulowski on and off for a couple of years. You have grad transfer in Connor LeCouvier, and you have Bryce McKay coming last year. And then after that, you don't know what's going to happen this year, and they bring in a pretty, you know, what looks like could be a promising freshman in Jackson Stauber, and McKay takes the reins again. You know, you just never know with that position, as you well know.
Didn't Stauber leave now, too?
Yeah, Stauber left right before Thanksgiving, went back to junior hockey. So he's back in Sioux Falls, and he's, you know, I mean, I don't know if he saw the writing on the wall thinking, I might be behind this guy for 3 years, and I want to get, you know, I want to make sure that I'm in a spot where I can compete and play. And so he chose to go back to junior hockey, and, you know, one of those things where you kind of go, well, I can't blame him, but then you wonder, hey, if you're the backup goalie on a potential, you know, WCHA championship contender, or possibly a national championship contender, you never know when the goaltending, when that next guy is going to be needed, whether it's because of injury, because of a dry spell, whatever it might be. But, you know, he decided to go, a separate ways.
I got to admit, I didn't realize that McKay was only a sophomore. That's depressing from our perspective.
No, and it has been pretty impressive, the run they've been on, because I know I've talked to, I can't think your, Todd, is it Knott or Knott?
Knott. Todd Knott.
Yeah, I've talked to him a couple times down at the showcase here in Blaine, and you know, it's always amazing how they find a way to get another goalie that does really well, and there's always seems to be turnover, yet it's always somebody steps up and puts up good numbers, and then, you know, Dryden's kind of taking it to the extreme this year. But, yeah, it seems like no matter who you guys get in there, somebody steps up and does well, and that's a good thing. It's just kind of amazing how the run they've been on with goalies and the turnover, but the success.
Yeah, and I think part of that, you know, I think they feel like they have a really good goaltending coach, a volunteer assistant, Brendan Potter's a who's been with him for quite a while now. He does a great job with the goaltenders. And, you know, a lot of times, even as good as those goalies have been, consistently over the 7 years here, a lot of times they don't even get the credit maybe they deserve, because people have raved about the way Minnesota State plays defensively in front of them and holding opponent shots on goal to around 20 to 22 a game. And so those goaltenders don't necessarily see a lot of shots. But I do think that Dryden McKay is different in just the way he plays, his demeanor, his consistency. You know, even when those other guys were going well, you would see them, you know, maybe, you know, give up, you know, every other weekend, you know, a bad goal or this or that. You just don't necessarily see that with Dryden McKay right now. And a lot of credit goes to him. And when you're batting 955 on the save percentage, I don't care how good the defense is in front of you, that's pretty darn good.
Yeah, it is. It's pretty impressive. So you've kind of seen them play pretty much everybody so far in conference. Like, what are your impressions of the rest of the league this year?
Yeah, well, I haven't seen them play Bemidji yet, which I'm really curious about, because obviously they had a good strong start to the season as well. So I haven't seen them play, and I don't think they have not played Fairbanks yet. But yeah, I think as far as the league goes, you know, saw Bowling Green come into town and, you know, take a game. And I think they're really good again, even with the coaching change. I'm really, you know, was really impressed. You know, they had so many veterans back as well. And I think that's the key in this league, is just the veterans and the way they're playing. It's interesting to see Tech right now kind of, you know, went through a little bit of a lull there and kind of rebounded really nicely since then. And, you know, I thought they played strong, especially, I think, was it the second night against Minnesota State, where Dryden McKay was kind of the difference in that game in the first period, where MSU got a little loose defensively, gave up a few odd man rushes and a breakaway, and I think he stopped 31 shots that night, if I'm not mistaken. And so, you know, that was a chance for another team to try to take some points off Minnesota State, and they weren't able to, but it seemed like they rebounded well after that weekend. You know, Northern, they're just an interesting team because of the turnover that they've had from last year. And like I said, Bemidji, I want to see them play yet and before making a real determination. Lake Superior is interesting, and I know they lost a lot of key guys from last year, but also have a lot of key guys back. So I'm a little surprised about them, you know, being off to a little bit of a slower start. I would have expected them to have a little better first half themselves. But I think it seems to be a strong, you know, it seems to be a bit stronger conference right now, than I think it's been. And I think it's going to be a pretty competitive second half.
Yeah, I definitely think it's at least six deep, and it seems like, and maybe it's Ferris's schedule the last couple weeks, but they're finally getting better. And I agree with you. I don't really understand. Like, I know Lake State lost a lot, or lost a decent amount, but I'm kind of surprised they're where they're at. But some of that is, I do think, you know, Minnesota State's probably a little better than people thought. Bemidji State is certainly outperforming my expectations. So is Alaska. And then Bowling Green, yeah. Tech, and Northern. Like, it's still pretty top heavy. I guess it's not all that surprising that there's kind of two stratifications right now, with Anchorage and Huntsville at the bottom, and then Lake State and Ferris kind of hoping to make, or, you know, expecting to make playoffs, but maybe not fighting for home ice. And then you got, you know, Minnesota State at the top, and then five other teams trying to get the other three home ice spots.
Yeah, I think maybe the biggest surprise to the league is maybe not necessarily Bemidji's record, but the way they're doing it. They're scoring a lot of goals. That's the thing that I keep seeing is, and that's not, you know, when they've made their good runs, it's usually been goaltending and defense first, with some timely goals sprinkled in, and they've scored a lot of goals this season. So, I think that's kind of been impressive to watch, and we'll see if that kind of lasts into the second half.
Did you guys even realize that? Bemidji State's 10th in the country in goals scored per game.
I just pulled up their schedule to look at it, and they've put up 7 twice this year.
What did you? They're 10th right now in goals per game. Did you say
in the country? Yeah,
in the country. Wow,
That's like the exact opposite of what I think of when I think of Bemidji State, for sure.
For as much as we talked, the week before, about the question about how boring the WCHA is based on shots?
Right.
We have 4 teams in the top 13 in the country in scoring offense right now.
Yeah, I think there's, right now I think their reputation kind of precedes them. I think people kind of look at the last few years, and they look at the bottom half of the league, and they know about what's happening with the teams leaving in after next season, and they know about the bottom. And all that stuff combined, I think that gives the league a certain reputation that I think it's really, defying this year. It's not just Minnesota State being number one. They're number two now, but it's not just that. I think it's the number of teams that are scoring goals. It's the solid... the solid defensive play. And another thing, I was talking to Mike Hastings about this before going up to Northern Michigan. If you look at the really good veteran defensemen in this league, the seniors, Ian Scheid, Philip Ballou, Alec Rauhauser, you start going through some of these defensemen who have played a ton of minutes and a ton of games. And these guys are going to be pro hockey players, in a year. I just think it's an impressive, there's just some impressive things about the WCHA this year that, you got to kind of crunch the numbers, like you guys said, or just then kind of start realizing, hey, it's a dangerous league. And you know what? They're also doing this year. They're playing pretty well in non-conference play.
They are.
I mean, have a solid weekend. I mean, went toe-to-toe with Clarkson this weekend. I mean, I just think that it just seems stronger all in all.
Yeah, and we talked a little bit last week about the upcoming non-conference games. We got, 15 of them left, Dustin? Is that right?
Yes, that should be right, yes.
Because the only ones this weekend were Clarkson Tech. And we kind of talked maybe they'd win 8 of those. Now we're looking at 6 or 7, maybe, with Tech not winning any last weekend.
We said 8 or 9.
8 or 9, and I think we kind of expected one of them to be last weekend. But
we got it's a tie, so
yeah, we got
counts for half.
The next 2 weeks, between your trip to Mariucci Classic and Tech at the GLI, there'll be 4 teams at those 2 tournaments, and it'll be interesting to see how many non-conference games we actually get out of those 2 tournaments, whether or not Bemidji and Minnesota State end up meeting in Tech and Ferris. But it's going to be an interesting couple weeks to see how the teams do going into that first weekend of the new year when Tech plays Arizona State and see where you come out. It's going to be a big thing that helps determine whether or not we're looking at 1 bid, 2 bids, 3 bids, who knows. And then it's just going to be a matter of not finding a way for the teams that have a chance at a at-large bid to not lose to those bottom 3-4 teams in the league and kill their pairwise.
Right. And I think the hope is if everyone's done, better, if everyone's in a little bit safer position pairwise, where that's not going to kill you like it has for Bowling Green, in recent years. And it almost killed them last year. I mean, it's just that they went into that championship game. They thought needing to win. As it turned out, as that game went on, they were in because of other results from that night. But they were, because of a loss to Huntsville late in the year, suddenly they dropped way down in the pairwise, and suddenly the pressure was on to try to win a WCHA championship game at Mankato. And you just hope that they don't kill themselves and put themselves in a position where it's really difficult. Where you have to make sure you can't stumble, you can't have a hiccup, and that puts a lot of pressure on these teams, I think, throughout the year, and I think it makes it tougher even come tournament time. I'm not saying that's why MSU hasn't won an NCAA tournament game yet, But, you know, I think maybe there is a little bit of a factor there where you have to be so careful during the season where, you know, in, at least in the past, if you're an NCHC team, you lose at Miami or you lose at Colorado College, but when those teams were at the bottom of their conference, it wasn't hurting them.
Yeah, you can win three out of every four games or, you know, go 500 for a couple weeks and you're still in a good place because, whereas, you know, Tech, we did the math, and if Tech had lost one of those games to Anchorage, they lose 200 points in the pairwise, but they swept and they basically dropped a couple spots because of what happened elsewhere. So, like, it, you know, like, and I think we talked a little bit about that last week when Drew Evans was talking about Eigner and how he gets really nervous when you play these bad teams because they're almost the more important games because, you know, winning doesn't help you, but losing kills you, and losing also kills
right.
the perception of the whole league to everybody, like the top teams.
Yeah.
But the problem is, like, if we have four teams in the top of our league, that means between those four teams, they're getting, you know, a minimum of six games against those bottom three, four teams. And so we've got six chances to lose, whereas the rest of the country has like 12 total. And
right,
and it can
right.
really add up where we look bad because we're the ones that lose to those teams, but we have a lot more chances to do it, and it's just tough. But yeah, I think they're in a better place this year.
Right, and it's tough in a sport like hockey where, you know, a good goaltending performance or, you know, your power play or whatever it might be just kind of can change the way a game goes, and suddenly you're scrambling. You know, even Minnesota State on Saturday night up at Northern. I mean, they weren't. I know they started a different goalie, and he wasn't bad, but they also didn't give him any goal support. And Nolan Kent played really well for Northern, and Minnesota State gets its first loss in a long time. I don't think it killed them a lot. I think they went from 1-3 in the pairwise, but it's also December 14th or whatever it is today.
Yeah.
So maybe it's not so terrible right now, but you know, it's just weird things can happen and really change the way things look in those rankings.
Yeah, so you brought up the NCHC and the whole teams leaving stuff from the Mankato perspective. Where is all that sitting at for you guys? I'm kind of excited that this might be the last week we have to talk about this for at least a month.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Well, since we don't really know anything more than we knew on June 28th when this all dropped, you know, we don't have to talk about it.
That's true.
It's a weird time right now in college sports. I mean, you're looking at, I mean, it's unrelated, but College State dropping football is a big deal. Enrollment's down. Minnesota Duluth just laid off a bunch of faculty. I mean, there's all kinds of things in college, in you know, just not just college sports, but, you know, university situations that everyone's got to be a factor of and pay attention to. You know, it wasn't all that long ago people were worried about, you know, the viability of Lake Superior State, not just their athletes, but the school. So, you know, everyone's got to, if everyone's going to do this the right way, a la the NCHC, I've been as big a critic of the way the NCHC went about this from the beginning, at least how they announced things, how they put this all together, but you can't argue with their success now that we're in 2019, not just on ice, but what they do in all the other aspects of what they do. It's a model college sport conference, and I think that's what these seven programs, especially Minnesota State and Bowling Green and Tech and Bemidji, those in Northern, the schools that really focused on fixing their own house after conference realignment. I think they got to know that everybody's in on this and to do it the right way and to do it in a way much like I think the NCHC has done it.
Yeah, it's hard to argue with everything they do. I mean, I like their app I got to watch one of the Minnesota State Duluth games for free on the app. I like their product. I was a little annoyed that you can't embed their highlights, but I guess they want you to go to their website all the time. But no, like, I like everything they do. I like the whole, the far more, instead of just our conference call where nobody knows how to mute their phone, you know, you've got you've actually got like an in-person get together somewhere to like promote the league. It's hard to argue with what they're doing, but
yeah,
it'll be interesting to see how many, like, what kind of requirements these, you know, the three or four teams that are really pushing this impose on all seven or eight of them to make it happen. Because we've talked a lot about, I think as Tech fans, we're pretty spoiled when it comes to WCHA TV stuff.
Yeah, I would agree with that.
And when you go watch another team produce a road game that Tech's on, like, you're like, what is this product? Like, why is the score not right? Why is the clock not right? What are the penalties right now? Like, you're just lost in it. And it feels like you're watching, like, public access.
No, the public access TV we get to watch is great. Bemidji is public access TV.
They're not anymore. Their production's
fantastic.
They were.
Oh, yeah, they were. Yeah.
They were, right.
But, yeah, it's crazy how... I really like the teams, and I feel bad for the three that are currently being left behind, but at the same time, like, I just don't feel like they're as invested. But I also feel like some of the other, you know, five schools that are part of this are also, like, not quite pulling their weight and doing everything the way I would hope the new league is going to make them do it. But we'll see.
Well, more than just the online content, like, yeah, and streaming, like you're saying. I think there's facility issues in those schools. I think there's a big facility issue with Ferris.
Yeah.
There's not a lot different from Ferris's arena to the arena that we're complaining about every week in Anchorage that they're playing in now.
No, it's just the video looks a little better because you're not looking through a net, but it's still low ceiling. I mean, I've never been there myself, but when I was at the showcase, one of the coaches was joking that the ceiling there, like at the showcase, was higher than the ceiling at the one at Ferris. So it's kind of a crazy place.
I love how we've all skated around trying to actually pronounce the name this entire time.
I'm not even trying. I'm not going there. The place at Ferris. Yeah.
That's why I'm a writer, not a broadcaster. I can just write it.
Yeah, that makes it easier.
But yeah, like you said, there's definitely some facility issues at some of the other schools that are a part of the seven. So... You know, what do they do to make that better as we go forward?
And, you know, the production quality of the TV stuff.
The highlight packages. We've talked about that a couple of times, and that's one of the things that there's a big difference in the way some of the teams do highlights across the league as well. Some of them are super frustrating to watch. I don't understand how you can have a highlight package that doesn't show every goal that's scored in a game. That makes no sense to me.
Yeah.
Yeah, I 100% agree, and I think that's... And those are the kind of things that you have to build that fan engagement too, especially if you go forward. You have to find a way to make sure that people are invested in this. And it's a tough time in college sports right now. And I think we're seeing, you know, I saw somebody make a comment about I think Pat Royce on the Star Tribune on his Twitter. He made mention of a really small crowd at St. Cloud State this weekend and was wondering about college hockey crowds and what the problem is. Well, you know, one area where maybe the WCHA is kind of lucky right now is you have, hey, Minnesota State's, you know, averaging 4,500 people a game roughly right now. Michigan Tech has had great crowds, you know, seemingly, you know, especially in post-conference realignment. Ferris, you can say what you want about their building, but it always looks like there's a lot of students there. You know, Bowling Green's doing great. Bemidji does okay. I know they had a few attendance issues not that long ago because they were worried about TV, and I think their games were taken off the public access for they were hoping that would get more people to go to the rink. But you're fighting all that stuff, and you change leagues and you change all that stuff. You got to find a way to really engage. I think the fan experience. Because I think that's part of it, especially if they decide that they want to, I don't know if they would want to do this, but if they want to have a conference tournament, a neutral site, you know, like the old Final Five, that sort of thing. I don't know if they would, but if that's something that's part of what they want to try to do, you have to build that fan engagement throughout the season.
Well, I mean, look at the Big Ten attendance right now. Minnesota and Wisconsin are just a shell of what they used to be from a fan engagement perspective. Mariucci looks, it's downright depressing to see a picture of Mariucci.
Yeah, that's not good. That's not good for the sport. I mean, that's not good for the sport across the board.
Yeah, that's supposed to be your big flagship school over there in Minnesota, and it's...
Yeah, I don't know what's going on with the Big
sad.
Ten. It's weird. I
think they priced everybody out. It's plain and simple. They priced out their fans. Not everybody can pay this, you know.
I think they were charging like $5 tickets their last home series. So if they're if it's lowering prices, isn't doing it, I don't know what's going to do it.
You've pissed off a lot of your base, though. You got people that were season ticket holders for years that were priced out of their seats by asking for more and more money that have just stopped following the program. And then you take and steal all of the in-state rivalries away to go to a league that, frankly, I don't think a lot of Minnesota fans care about from a hockey perspective, and it's a recipe for wrong.
And once you lose those fans, you can't get them back.
They didn't want to do it, though. I'll say that.
Well, as long as we brought up the Gophers, I have one other thing that we could probably all talk about a little bit. You know, over the weekend, we lost Doug Woog, a former player, coach, and broadcaster. While I've never been a huge fan of the Gophers, it's still a big loss, because before we had a WCHA streaming package, I remember spending a lot of time watching Gopher games, especially hanging out with you, Dustin. We didn't always have anything else to do other than listen to Tech and watch the Gophers.
Well, for quite a few years there where we were roommates, that was the only college hockey game you could find on TV.
Yeah, and I remember it being like the only college hockey games I got to watch when I lived in Ohio was when Tech played at Minnesota. So I always remember watching Woog and Frank Mazzocco and having a blast enjoying those games. I know they were always fun to watch. You know, my condolences to his family and the Gopher hockey community. Anybody else have anything else you wanted to say about that?
That's one of the guys I can remember from being a little kid when they used to come up to Tech. You know, we've had good buddies that have come over from Minnesota for a while, and they've always had good things to say about Woog. So, yeah, it's definitely sad to see.
Yeah, you know, it's really sad, and I, you know, my condolences go out to his family and all the people who played for him. And I, you know, and I thought he and Frank were great on TV when they would play in Mankato. It was fun to just talk to him just for a couple minutes. He'd always have a comment here or there to say. When he was kind of starting to get done broadcasting, he sat next to me in the press box for a Gopher Maverick game, and we had a good time. I was really enjoying listening to him talk about. He had a comment about somebody dumped a puck in, did the whole thing where they dumped a puck in at the red line and went off for a change, and he got mad. He said he always hated it when players do that. I'm like, well, what if they're at the end of their shift and they just need to do that? He's like, just if you're at the end of your shift, just get off the ice. I just thought it was so funny. But yeah, you know, the thing is about Doug Woog that I always appreciated was, you know, for me, when I started covering college hockey, I was the editor at Let's Play Hockey for 5 years before I moved to Mankato. And it was late 90s, 1995, I started that job, and Gopher hockey was huge. I mean, we mentioned earlier about the attendance at Mariucci and how sad that might be right now, but, in the late 90s, when the North Stars were gone and the Wild hadn't started up yet, Gopher hockey was kind of king when it comes to hockey in Minnesota, and you get 10,000 people there, and his teams were really good at the time, and I know, you know, he didn't win a national championship, but I just remember some big games there and listening to him and talking to him as I was this neophyte hockey reporter who didn't necessarily know a ton about the sport. I just always appreciated talking to him. I never felt like I was out of the loop or outside some strange hockey inner circle that you know, I wasn't supposed to be around. I always felt good talking to him. And so, you know, I just have a, if there's a little, you know, I just a little sadness, you know, because I think about my career and covering a lot of his games and talking to him a lot early on. And so, he'll really be missed.
Yeah.
Well, thanks for joining us, Shane. I think we'll get back to more of our WC or our tech topics here. I think we can probably let you
all right.
go and enjoy the rest of your night. Thanks for joining us.
Yeah, thanks, Shane.
Hey, you're welcome. Anytime, guys. Thanks a lot.
Yep. Thanks, Shane. Before we start, I have one big thing to talk about. We have our first patrons on our patron site, our Patreon site. And beyond giving all of them a big thank you for being first, maybe we should take a little bit of time to explain what exactly is going on with Patreon and what kind of benefits you can get by signing up yourself. We currently have two levels of support. Our lowest level is the white level with the nice classic Husky Dog logo from like the 70s. It's based on a $2 per month gift, and you receive question priority, a link to our Discord chat, which a bunch of you probably already have because we used to just give it out like candy, and then a thank you note from us, a special thank you from us on the podcast, which we're kind of doing right now. The next level is the black level, which requires $5 a month, and you receive everything on the white level, plus an early release of our podcast, plus extra content, because we like to edit it down to a more palatable 60 minutes, but you die hard, you're probably going to get closer to 90 minutes most weeks. We'll see how that really goes over the next month or two. But we usually try and publish the full episode on Patreon around, you know, late Tuesday night. Depends on how much time I have to edit. And then the last gift that we're doing for now for sign up while supplies last is an authentic MTU hockey jersey patch. We basically have the choice between the new Husky Dog logo or the UP patch, both patches that the team currently wears on their black road jerseys. For more information, you can check out our Patreon page at patreon.com/techhockeyguide. And now let's give out a thanks to our first four patrons. Rob, you want to go first?
Sure. Thanks to Steve Buck for joining.
And Dustin, you got a name too?
Yeah. Going to give a shout out to Mark Bailey for being one of our first patrons. Thank you.
And then I'd like to say thank you to Marvin Wilson for also signing up this week. And I recognize him a little bit already from the Discord chat. He had a nice little comment even to earlier this week about the Joe Show that we will kind of touch on a little bit later. And then lastly, we'd like to thank our editor, Alex Sleepak, for signing up and being the fourth patron. We really appreciate all of you guys taking the time to sign up, and we hope you enjoy the extra content. If we can get a few more patrons to sign up, I will start doing a monthly podcast covering recruiting and probably have interviews with future players and or some junior coaches like Brad Patterson or maybe Pat Mikish. We'll see how that all goes. Now back to our regular discussion. We talked a little bit about Clarkson, but we didn't really get a chance to talk about the Joe Show before Shane came on. And there were a couple pretty interesting tidbits to discuss. Probably the biggest one came from Mighty Texter on Twitter. He made a comment about how Joe is demonstrating he misunderstands millennials and effectively telling potential recruits to look elsewhere. I think the first point I want to make is any potential recruit is not a millennial anymore. They're too young. But beyond that, Dustin, you kind of had something you wanted to say about this, didn't you? Millennials? No?
Did I?
Yeah.
I guess all I was going to say is that part of the conversation didn't really bother me because I think a lot of the points that Joe was making were grounded in truth, and I don't like the generalization of saying that the entire group of millennials, the entire generation, is this way. But you see a lot of these same complaints from coaches across a bunch of different sports, And it seems like it's a trend in sports now. And I think there's maybe something there. It doesn't mean that it's an excuse for that Joe should be using, because it's his job to coach this age kids. So yep. it is his, he needs to deal with it. I don't have a whole lot of sympathy for him on it, but.
The bigger problem is the, but I guess it doesn't really sound a whole lot better if he's just like kids these days. You know, it's just in general that, like, I think he's just better off talking in more general terms about how, you know, youth has always had a problem with selfishness. And it's very hard. I think he made a good point just talking about how we have to constantly remind ourselves and other people that there are other people to worry about, not just yourself. But that's an ongoing thing for all of us. Like, even now, and I guess I'm almost a millennial, but, like, you know, we all have that all the time where, like, you have to remember that what you do affects other people, not just yourself. And it's a hard thing to remind yourself. And with the instant gratification that we get with the internet and everything else these days, it's very easy to just focus on you and just ignore the we and all of it. And I don't blame Joe for being frustrated with that, but he has to understand that that's not really anything new.
Well, I think the instant gratification thing, we've talked about it a couple times, just with stuff like ordering stuff online just to get the podcast going, right?
Right.
You know, as we were talking about getting equipment, when we've ordered things off of, you know, more specialty sites that aren't Amazon, and it takes us 3 days to get something, and we're all getting frustrated.
Yeah.
But I don't think that's a millennial thing. That's just a culture of the times we live in thing more than a millennial thing.
Yeah, but but
everybody now expects that. I watch people that are older get frustrated when their website doesn't load. That's not just millennials. That's everybody in this instant gratification culture.
Yeah, but it's I think it is a little different when you are, you know, coming of age and maturing in that type of situation compared to it being exposed to it when you're older for the first time. I think that has a bigger impact on players today than you guys do, because that constant want to be on, you know, a SportsCenter top 10 and be able to go onto YouTube and watch your highlights
or get talked about by Buchacross or whatever, yeah,
or tweet your commitment,
yeah.
How many followers do you have on Twitter and all that stuff? That none of that existed 10 years ago, and that has to have some impact on it. Kids have been selfish for years, but it is easier for them to be selfish now.
That's true. And I also think your high school, your younger kids, like the star athletes are getting coddled a lot more than they did 10, 15 years ago. You look at that with college football and everything else, like they get handed everything because the coaches need them to do well. And at a certain point, those kids start playing other kids like them, and they're not as good anymore. Like, you can't put up 70 points like you did in BC or Manitoba or wherever. Like, you have to work at it, and you're not just going to get it because you're the best kid on the ice every night. Like, that's not the way it is anymore. And I think kids struggle with that, too.
Looking at that from the other coin, though, one of the things Joe mentioned on the show is that he compares a lot of what he's doing to parenting. These guys are adults. Let's not look at it as parenting them anymore. Treat them as adults and maybe they won't be so coddled. There's got to be some blame on the generation above that's treating the kids this way, that's perpetuating the coddled response. If they continue to get coddled, they're being parented rather than being, I don't know, part of this is these guys they're college-age students. They don't need parenting. I think that's the wrong word to use there part of the time to me.
Well, I don't think it is, because it's not. It's more like, I think part of that culture Joe's trying to create is a family environment, and that comes from, like, he's the patriarch figure of that family, that he's going to be the parent, and it's more of a...
I think mentoring is a better term to use there than parenting.
Well, I think you're telling somebody they're wrong. That, like, parenting stops when your kid goes to college. You know, like,
I'm not,
like,
trying to say that.
Like, I get you're saying mentorship, but at the same time, like, you know, like, Mighty Texter talks about him being afraid that recruits will get turned off because the way he's talking you know, he doesn't understand them. And I don't think that's the case at all either. I think he does. And I think his biggest struggle is like the way he talks is that, yes, he understands that these kids, there is a lot of me. And I think that's a lot of what he's trying to do is teach them that there's more to it than that. And that like the more he's able to teach them that the team success breeds individual success, that he's going to get through and get what he wants out of them. And I think even if they don't realize it, like, I think that resonates still that like, you know, team success is important. You don't want to be the best kid on Alaska Anchorage, do you? When they win four games, like you just, that's not what you want. You want to be a part of a winner and it's okay to be the second best center on the best team in the league. You know, like, I don't think anybody's complaining about being the fourth line guy on Minnesota State right now.
Dryden McKay was complaining about being the backup goalie.
Right. No, I think my point there though is just that I think a lot of it is really negative toward millennials by everybody else, right?
Right. It's a terrible trope. That's the problem.
Right. Yeah. And I struggle with the fact that the generations that have raised millennials have like completely distanced themselves from the fact that they're the ones that raise kids this way. They completely disavow any blame whatsoever.
Yeah. Like you in our chat, you were making the point about like, you're the guys that invented the participation trophy, not us.
Right.
Like you're just, we just took them.
Right. Yeah. You handed trophies to small children for years and now they don't get them and it's a big deal. Who made them expect that?
Or like the whole
take some
like,
blame
we don't
yourself.
Keep score, but yet all the little kids know who won, right? Like,
right. Yeah, exactly. T-ball has to always be a tie. Why? I'm pretty sure as little kids we understood who was playing better than the other in T-ball.
Says the guy
but you
that
made
says
every
ties
single
are okay.
T-ball game a tie. Ties are okay as long as they're not forced.
All right.
But I don't know. I don't want to go too deep into the social rant because I think that puts us in a bad place if we haven't already gone there.
No. And the only other thing that really came up on the Joe show, unless Dustin wants to give us his weekly take on, I don't remember what you call it. Whatever, you can go for it.
You mean this week's analogy of the week?
Yes, the analogy of the week. I think we're gonna have to get some kind of audio drop for that. I'll work on it.
Perfect. Yeah, I think that would be great. So this week's Joe Sean analogy of the week, and this is a classic, but the first time that we've talked about it on this podcast.
Yeah, an oldie but a goodie.
Yes. This week, Joe compared defense to a dog and offense to a cat. I'll just leave it at that, and you can interpret it any way you want.
I think my favorite part of the analogy of the week is that Dustin provides no context. He just gives exactly what was said, and that's perfect for the segment.
Well, I think
like,
we've
go
all heard
listen
that
to it.
One
figure
enough,
out,
so
figure out what he said.
For the listeners who aren't Joe Show fans, like that might be interesting, but I don't know how many of them we actually have. We'll have to see.
I would imagine there's got to be quite a bit of overlap between our audiences there, at least at this point.
If you're not a Michigan Tech fan and you're listening right now, let's get a tweet to the Chasing Mac Pod account so we can find out who's actually listening that's not Tech fans.
Do we have to have a Dustin Now Explains part, or do people get the fact that we're saying something off the Joe Show?
Give us a tweet that says, I support such and such team, so we know what's going on here. That'd be great.
I just love that we've done this not too many episodes so far, and every one that I've been on, I've been able to pull an analogy out of the Joe Show so
far. You have, except I think a couple of them didn't make it past the cutting room floor for time, but...
Oh. Gotta go on Patreon.
You gotta go on Patreon to listen to all of them, and I felt so bad because we name dropped AppArch for doing the hate listen, and then I cut it for time, so it was only available on Patreon, and I couldn't get him to hate pay $5 a month to listen. So I'll drop it again, and maybe this won't get cut. All right, so I think we're just gonna go right into more questions. So one of my college roommates, Mark Hill, decided to ask a whole bunch of questions. Let's see how much we want to try and touch on these. Does MTU support athletics to the same level as successful programs like UMD and Wisconsin, etc.? First off, I'm going to just laugh at you, Mark, for including Wisconsin in this because they are kind of, they're decent, but their program is not really in good shape right now in the Big Ten, and they haven't been good basically since, what, 4 years before they fired their last coach?
They haven't been good, but it's not been for a fault of money. I mean, from a support perspective, from the administration side,
that's true.
They have one of the top paid staffs in the year or in the country, right?
But like, yeah, they're not. Their coaching staff costs, what, probably like $800,000 a year, something like that?
Right, it's absurd.
It's crazy. But like,
bottom line,
they're not getting their bang for their buck because they can't even win a questionable Big Ten.
No.
I mean, bottom line is, over the last six or seven years, Michigan Tech has been hands down the more successful team in the Wisconsin. And it really isn't even close.
No. To bluntly answer the question, I think Michigan Tech is doing a great job of supporting their team. I think the behind-the-scenes stuff is going well. You know, Joe is not underpaid. Joe has not had a problem keeping his assistants. I think they get paid pretty well comparative to, you know, maybe not the top five programs in the country, but they're right there with everybody else. I think, you know, Joe's paid well. You know, he's given the ability to keep a guy like Tyler Shalast around. It helps that Tyler probably isn't that motivated to leave because he's got a connection there. And the facilities are good behind the scenes. The rink is good. The facelift looks, you know, has been awesome. The scoreboard's good. The suites are helping everything. The attendance is good. The production quality and the athletic department ability to provide good content online and everything else is good. Michigan Tech is in the top third, as far as I'm concerned, as far as quality from top to bottom. Anybody disagree with that?
No, and it is a night and day difference from when I was a student at Tech to what it is now. I don't know what the difference in investment or spending is between now and then, but the difference in quality of everything from facilities that you can see, from facilities you can't see, to the product they put on the ice, everything is so much better than it used to be. It's not even really comparable.
No, I think some of it's just been, you know, Suzanne's done a great job of getting the right people involved, and the people that are doing it care. And I've talked about that a couple times on the show where it just feels like some of these other teams, especially in the WCHA, don't take enough pride in what they're doing. And I don't get that sense from Tech at all, from a production side or the athletic side. Like, you know, Calvin Larson's always great about getting back to me in a timely manner on most stuff, getting me pictures when I ask for them. And the Tech community is great on so many levels. And Joe's been good for that.
How many other universities do you hear about a fan bus going to one of their farthest road trips, right?
Right.
The Misfits are going to Huntsville this year.
Are they?
Yeah.
Nice.
The Misfits are doing an organized trip to Huntsville this year.
Awesome. I love it.
That is not something you hear about at other schools for the most part.
No. Not a regular season game, not at all.
Right.
But that's cool. That's probably why I haven't heard much about other games, because they're saving their money for that. Tech supports their athletics well, especially the hockey team.
Oh, it's the crown jewel of the sports side. But even if you look at the rest of that, though, the athletic department, I mean, it's obviously the only D1 sport, but Tech basketball has been a fantastic program for a long time, too. On the men's and the women's side, they've both had their successes. You know, the football team was nearly taken out, and canceled. But they're now remodeling Sherman Field, right?
Yeah.
I mean, so athletics in general at Tech, I think, are ran extremely well from the administration side, and it shows.
No, I think Suzanne is a great leader for that program top to bottom. You know, she's been good to us. She's just done a really good job of finding the right coaches. And, you know, when she talks on the broadcast, she does a good job of talking about how, you know, the UP is not for everybody, but, you know, she does a really good job of finding people that want to be there, and her coaches do a really good job of finding athletes that want to be there.
Yeah.
Well, that should do it for this episode of the Chasing McNaughton podcast. Check out our Patreon and join by visiting patreon.com/tech hockey guide. Patrons at the black level or above receive an authentic MTU jersey patch and access to extra podcast content, including the unpublished episode zero, which is up now, as well as the extended version of last week's episode and probably this week's, because we're sitting at 100 minutes right now. Follow us on Twitter at ChasingMacPod or at TechHockeyGuide. You can submit questions through our email address, ChasingMac@TechHockeyGuide.com, or send us a voice message directly on anchor.fm/ChasingMacPod. Don't forget to subscribe to the podcast on Apple, Google, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts. If you can't find the podcast on your site of choice, please let us know. We'll make that happen. Please check out Jonathan Zemeda's series previews every Friday and Mike Antleitner's Old Dog in Texas column every Wednesday. I believe this week you're going to get a special column from Jonathan to talk about rules and referees. We'll see how that goes. There should be some semi-regular content on Mondays and Tuesdays going forward from Matt Cavender and myself. I hope to have out some recruiting content this week or maybe next week. You can find all this and more at techhockeyguide.com. We have a couple extra thank yous this week. One more shout out to our first group of patrons, Steve Buck, Marvin Wilson, Mark Bailey, and Alex Sleepak. And thanks to Mitch Lake for being kind enough to record a new introduction for the podcast. As always, special thanks to our patron, St. Doc McResin, for his generous donation to get this thing running. We hope you enjoy. Also, thanks to the thank you notes for all the bumpers in this week's episode. If you like what you hear, check them out at thethankyounotes.bandcamp.com.
Random stat question for you. Who's got the best plus minus on the team right now?
The best plus minus?
Is this a...
Yeah, I was surprised by it.
Is this a test?
No. I was surprised by it looking here as I'm looking around.
Rockwell.
Soretsky.
Yep. No, Rockwell's got it. Plus six.
Plus six. Maybe I'll leave that on there while the music's playing.
Yeah. Sure.
I'm figuring must be better than this, the blood, the sweat, and the tips, the love, remember to get the blood beginning to slip between the fingers of the one who never had a chance. 20-something-year-old renegade working with his hands, living to be the man, giving into the plan. Sniff the 50-hour work week like a gram, drunken in dismay, sunken in his place. I didn't want to be this when I grow up, but it's okay. Bullshit, no way. Hit another joint, put some liquor in my old drink. That's okay, I guess I'll find another blonde who doesn't like my brother and doesn't know my mom. But when we collide, we make a nuclear bomb. She'll be alone as soon as the next one is on my arm. Be calm, relax, do that until it's gone. So basically, what you're telling me is backwards, backwards. On the block daily, on the backhand. Batman, seen a far thing, guitar string. Plays that song in my head all day. So follow. Telling me is backwards, backwards. On the block daily, on the back.